You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello everyone, and welcome to ART323. Let's get started. Our topic for today is the High Renaissance, which encompasses a pretty short amount of time, 1495 to 1520. And maybe the most famous artists of the Renaissance, we can talk about their work during this period of the High Renaissance. So in this lecture, we will be looking at the work of Michelangelo, Da Vinci, and Raphael. Let's start off with a setting. And the setting is that by the time of the High Renaissance, probably the most prolific patron of the arts was the Pope, and Pope Julius II. Pope Julius II, here you see a painting of Pope Julius II by Raphael, was also known as the Warrior Pope because he was willing to engage in, you know, military type of battles on behalf of the Vatican. And yet he was also a very important player in the story of High Renaissance art because Pope Julius recognized the power of visual imagery to support the religion of the church and also, in a way, as a propagandistic kind of enterprise that could keep everyone familiar with the wealth, the grandeur, and the power of the church. So one of his artists is Michelangelo, or was Michelangelo. And here you're looking at a portrait of Michelangelo attributed to an artist, da Volterra, but that attribution is questioned. However, we do believe that this is a portrait of Michelangelo. You have a detail on the left and you have the full portrait on the right. Michelangelo was known as Terribilità, meaning kind of a wild child. And he had such a talent that showed at a young age that his work, you know, could move people to heights of emotion. And yet he was, as a colleague of mine says, a special plant of a sort, meaning that he required special feeding and care, special watering to accomplish his artistic goals, and was not always easy to deal with. So Michelangelo, you probably have heard, for example, when he was told he would be painting the Sistine Chapel ceiling, wasn't really that enthusiastic about the commission. And I can give you a loose sort of summary of a comment he allegedly made was, "I prefer the chisel," meaning he really preferred sculpture. And yet, when commanded by the Pope to do a commission such as this during the period we're studying, he did it. And you may have also seen some of the movies about this story and how it was very difficult to build the scaffolding and to get the imagery on the top of the ceiling. It's all fresco. And it wasn't probably the easiest commission an artist ever had. So when we start to think about the Sistine Chapel ceiling, we have this artist driving the narrative who's rebellious and a bit at odds with his patron, right, the Pope. Let's talk about, I have a couple images here for you. It's really hard to depict the Sistine Chapel ceiling in just a few slides, so to speak. I would encourage you to get out on Google Images and get a three-dimensional sense of the work. He had to incorporate his visual program into existing architecture. Right there, you have a high level of difficulty. The ceiling, I hope you might want to return to this image later because it's a lot to take in at once. But here is the program, or the visual program, the stories and the figures and the arrangement of the scenes from the Bible that are on the ceiling. And if you just look briefly at the middle register or the middle bar here of this image, I have a couple that I'll show you in detail. And you see stories, Adam and Eve, Noah, the flood, Adam's drunkenness, God divides light from darkness. These are some of the stories presented on the ceiling. And then if you would look around the edges of this diagram, we have prophets and sibyls. Sibyls are female prophetesses. And other figures, the ancestors of Jesus. So just to give you a sense of how this had to be mapped out and planned, let alone painted. The creation of Adam is one of the most famous elements of the Sistine Chapel ceiling. And here, if you look only at the bodies for a moment, they really look like sculpture. They're well modeled. We know Michelangelo was often given the best pieces of marble when he made sculpture because he could do, you know, the finest work. So the bodies might even look a little heavy to you. And that's where we think we're seeing Michelangelo saying, okay, no matter what, I'm going to treat figures as I might sculpture. So you do have these bodies that look sculptural. And this is the very famous activation, so to speak, the creation. The two fingers are just about to match, Adam and God. And then there's a cluster of individuals in that sort of drapery cloud that brings God toward Adam. And lots of fun detective work about the figures. The woman, is it a woman? Right under God's arm, who looks a bit startled or has a certain kind of look. There have been a lot of theories about who that woman might be. I can't tell you anything conclusive. And then another person has posited, I'll just put this one out for fun, that shape with God and the other figures looks like a brain. And there's a lot of interest in science during the Renaissance. So it's just, I'll just suggest, you know, maybe we could say there's so much interest in secrecy and codes and finding hidden meanings during the period of the Renaissance that we may have gone off the rails a little bit with the brain idea or the brain shape, but it is just something to think about. Maybe put this in the package of the popularity of the images from the Sistine Chapel ceiling. The drunkenness of Noah. Here's another scene I wanted to show you. The shame of Noah's daughters when they see that he's drunk and naked, and that ties into a biblical theme that, you know, children shouldn't see their parents naked and nor drunk. And then along the sides of this one, you see the ignudi, or the nude male figures. Michelangelo put these figures in pretty strategically after he would have the fresco mapped out of the Bible scene. He would incorporate other figures to make it look very three-dimensional. The ignudi, you know, they're in a seated position, and he filled in the ceiling rather than just having a static presentation of panels. And those bodies are also very sculptural, and the ignudi are all over the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel ceiling. Let's move to Leonardo da Vinci, and I have three bulleted points here for you. Renaissance man is a very important term for this period. And what is it? Renaissance man is the man, and it is male dominant at this time, who can do more, can do everything. So Leonardo was known for his, I'm sure you're aware of this, his scientific interests. He was always planning projects. Some people see in his work things like, I always found this one fun, he may have thought of the first contact lens, the idea that one could wear a contact lens. He also was well-versed in math. And of course, painting. So Renaissance man comes to us even today, and we could say Renaissance woman today, Renaissance individual today, as someone who's talented in many areas. And that's very important in the Renaissance. Leonardo, as you have learned from your readings, was very interested in the study of anatomy. And yet, I want to highlight the last bullet point on this slide. Although there is, of course, a visceral interest, and I use that word on purpose, for studying anatomy during the Renaissance, and artists would look at corpses, for example, and really try to get an objective view, the treatment of the body that comes out of that study is still idealized in many ways. So we're still working with artistic models that come out, shall we say, edited, even though there is a very precise study of anatomy behind that. So that's kind of an interesting reality for this period. Now, Leonardo was born in Vinci, near Florence, and he went to work for one of the princely courts. We've studied the princely courts. And he worked for Ludovico Sforza, and under Ludovico's patronage, Leonardo painted the Madonna of the Rocks. There are two versions of the Madonna of the Rocks. And this is the central piece, was the central panel of an altarpiece. And just take it in for a few moments. Looking at the figures, look at that fantastic background landscape. Don't you want to just go to that place? And the gentle quality of the Virgin and that blue cloak she wears, it almost could be a scene of women, you know, with infants or babies out in nature having a picnic. But when we start looking at the hand gestures and we look more carefully, we know that there is a grouping there that is of a religious nature, Christian, part of the Christian stories. So we have John the Baptist, and we have figures pointing to one another because they're in a relationship that's also set off by the pyramidal form created by just the grouping of the figures. And we have the Madonna, the Virgin Mary, and we have, as mentioned, the infant John the Baptist and the Christ child. It is often said that Leonardo's accomplishment in this work was an atmospheric setting that unifies the objects. An atmospheric setting that unifies the objects. It feels more holistic. It looks more unified rather than having just the Virgin and the child set against a certain background. He really worked hard with perspective and atmosphere to unify these figures. Now, Leonardo is very famous for the Mona Lisa, and so many questions about this, songs sung by Frank Sinatra about Mona Lisa eyes. Who is she? Well, it is known that she was the wife of a wealthy Florentine banker. And it would be typical of a person of that class to be able to commission a famous artist for family portraiture. It is also argued that she doesn't have a lot of jewelry and she doesn't have fineries, and that some of the radicalness maybe of Leonardo here was he was trying to capture his sitter through personality and not so much through what she would be wearing. And that does lead to those eyes that appear to follow us, you know, wherever we move around, she seems to lock eyes with us. In addition, the backdrop, again, a nice atmosphere Leonardo's presented here, and he's put the figure in front of the atmospheric background, is probably not to be seen as a real place we could visit, but a composite. And the same would apply to Madonna of the Rocks. These backgrounds are attractive and imagined in many ways. Sfumato. This technique, I put the word smoky on the slide here. Leonardo really, using the oils, perfected this technique so that effects look a little bit, not blurry in the wrong way as an out of focus, but smoky and soft. And this was one of his subtle characteristics. So famously associated with Leonardo is the sfumato technique. I feel that you might be wondering about her face and her eyebrows, for example. And it is beauty. Historians of beauty and fashion tell us that very much plucked eyebrows, almost to the point of missing, were very stylish. It was a beauty convention of the time. And that appears to be part of the realism he's presenting in this portrait of Mona Lisa. This portrait has been stolen at least 2 times in history. You might ask yourself, why would someone steal such a famous image? What would you do with it? Because if you tried to sell it, everyone knows what it is. And one of the more interesting of those stories, in my opinion, is that once the robbers got the Mona Lisa, they had to hide it in their apartment because they really couldn't get rid of it. So lots of intrigue about the painting currently under bulletproof glass when it's on display. But did Leonardo intend for this to take on such a life? I don't know. It's an interesting question. I have an assignment for you now as we pause in this presentation. Please come back and complete this assignment, but I will just point out the basics of it. What I want you to do is go to figure 22.4, which is The Last Supper, very famous work by Leonardo, and then look at it. I think you probably know what it looks like, but study it further, and then, as I have written in the white here, choose one of the following depictions of The Last Supper by different artists. You can choose either figure 21.22 or figure 20.11. Look at them in the book, pick the one you like the most, and in a statement of 100 words, describe which of the 3 Last Supper depictions, including Leonardo's, you prefer and why, using as many art historical terms as possible. For example, terms like composition, setting, perspective, materials, and so forth. So look at the 3 choices, including Leonardo's, and choose the one you like the best. And then please look at the yellow text here. Post your 100-word statement to the Discussions tab on Blackboard in the section titled Last Supper by 11:59 p.m. on the Wednesday of week 6. I'm really looking forward to knowing who chose which Last Supper and why. And this will also help you go back and see that the Last Supper has been, we've already talked about that, it's a common subject during our period of study. So this assignment is due by 11:59 p.m. on Wednesday of week 6. Can't wait to see what we get. Let's return to the topic at hand and move to the artist Raphael. Now, Raphael was called to the papal court in Rome in the year 1508 by Pope Julius II. The Pope knew of Raphael's talent, and he called him to court in Rome. And the Marriage of the Virgin, which you're looking at right here, is one of the early works of Raphael. This is 1504, that allowed people to understand the talent that this younger person had. I don't know if you are familiar with the story of the Marriage of the Virgin. It comes from something called the Golden Legend, which I have noted on the right-hand side of the slide. In the 13th century, a compilation of the lives of the saints was made. So taking in all the stories and folklore, and then, you know, all of that was compiled into, let's call it a book called The Golden Legend. And The Golden Legend tells the story about Saint Joseph, who would be Joseph, right? And how he had to compete for Mary's hand in marriage. And Raphael took this story and rendered it in his Raphael-like way, which we'll get into a little bit more, his very specific use of color, for example. And if you look carefully, you see that Joseph has won because he's about to place a ring on Mary's finger, and she's got the blue cloak, so we know that's Mary. And yet, this competition, I guess, was sort of a bummer for others, because if you look at the figure on the lower right, do you see how his knee is bent and he's snapping a rod over his knee? Well, that is because, as the story goes, the high priest who's marrying Joseph and Mary in the Raphael here gave the winning suitor a rod to show you have won. And you can see Joseph's rod is in his left hand. But the people who lost, and there are some more guys who lost, right, on the right-hand side, they didn't receive the right staff or rod. So they were not chosen. And this guy's angry, and he's just snapping it over his knee. So there's a bit of emotion there that's kind of, I think it's pretty interesting. The group of women on the left are other virgins who apparently were in this competition. Some of you may be thinking of Greek myth right now and some of those stories about contests to get the virgin's hand. And we all know that all religions incorporate ultimately stories of other religions, even other religions they've supplanted. So it may be that that story of the marriage of the virgin has some roots in Greek myth. Looking again at this oil on wood, you can see the architectural interests of Raphael and the perspective. This is an early work. As he moves along, he'll abandon some of these ideas especially, but you will continue to see certain techniques. Let's look at the Madonna in the meadow, and we see that Raphael's teacher, Perugino, on the lower right here, this teacher really emphasized softer tonalities. And Raphael really doesn't give this up, the softer tonalities. Look at the red and the blue. He can make a form where just the color really establishes the form. And the Madonna in the meadow was painted while Raphael was in Florence. That composition that looks like a pyramid, her body with the two children, really appears to come from Leonardo. We have already talked about that. There's a tenderness that Raphael ascribes to his figures. I think you can see it in her face. And the hairstyle is of the Renaissance time, so he gives a bit of a contemporary element. And then the landscape has this high Renaissance favored, beautiful background with some editing and imagination. And if you look even at the two red flowers that work with the red of her garment, you can see a lot of composition and thought in this depiction. And this Madonna in the meadow really sets Raphael at a certain level for depicting the Madonna and child. And he has other depictions, and he was highly sought for such works. And by the way, that long cross with the crossing at the top is a symbol associated with John the Baptist. And today you've seen two depictions of John the Baptist as an infant. And remember, when you're thinking of time in the Bible, John the Baptist would, if we went with chronological time, be older than Christ. But stories change. The interpretations are shown, you know, if we tried to be specific, we have people in the Bible who live to be, you know, over 200 years old. So here's where we get the artists presenting the stories in interesting ways with some artistic license. So Raphael also gives us a very famous work called The School of Athens. And we're at the end of our time talking about specific images in this lecture, but The School of Athens is one you must study further and you will like. So when you look in the week's folder for this week, I have a specific assignment for you to get you engaged with Raphael's School of Athens. And I think you will find that that work is one of the most complex but interesting works of the High Renaissance.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.